How much would you pay to have a robot carve your name or company logo into the moon? Well, if you believe a group of students from the University of Texas, you could do so for the low, low price of $9.99 per second of doodling. Back in 2020, they submitted a proposal to NASA's annual design competition called Rascal. And not only did they win their category, Commercial Cislunar Space Development, they also got an Excellence in Commercial Innovation Award, which, let's be honest, is a bit unsettling. But this story got us thinking about an even more nightmarish scenario. What if somebody wanted to go full mad scientist and carve something into the moon that was so big we could see it from Earth? How big would that have to be? Well, we have to make a few assumptions and do some back-of-the-envelope math, but SciShow has the answer. Before we can talk about how big something would need to be on the moon to see it, we have to deal with human vision, which many of us know from firsthand experience isn't perfect. But vision can mean a couple of different things. Like, technically, the human eyeball is so sensitive it can perceive individual photons as flashes of light. But this episode isn't about setting up a flashing beacon on the moon. It's about carving an image that could be seen clearly with the naked eye from Earth. So instead, we're actually concerned with what scientists call visual acuity and the resolution of the human eye. Resolution is the ability to distinguish two things that are next to each other as separate entities. Think back to that classic vision chart with the large capital E at the top. In order to resolve the E, you need to be able to distinguish each of those horizontal lines as being their own thing, as well as the white spaces in between them. But resolution isn't the same for everyone, or even for one person at every single point in time. For one thing, it's just worse in the dark, when our eyes are picking up fewer photons. And if you're older or have a disability, the parts of your eyes that help you do the whole seeing thing can function differently. But even so-called average visual acuity is sort of arbitrary. One definition says it's based on seeing the difference between black lines on a white background. Of course, the real world isn't so, well, black and white. Lighting conditions and colors change all the time, but we've still sort of emerged with that 20/20 standard optometrists are trying to get you to. But hold on, we can't apply all that to the moon just yet. I'll tell you why after this more terrestrial, less lunar advertisement.
Thank you to Jump for supporting this SciShow video. Jump is a statistical analysis software that makes powerful analytics quick and accessible. For example, if you're trying to model when the benefits outweigh the costs in a switch to more energy-efficient transportation, the first model you use might not give you the information you need. You could end up accidentally overfitting your data. Instead, you'll need to actively evaluate, validate, and compare different models to make sure that you choose the best one for the job. And Jump facilitates that process. Jump's model screening platform lets you launch multiple models at once and evaluate their respective performances without having to go through each one individually. They also offer a 30-day free trial for anyone, anywhere. You can find it at jmp.com/scishow and see the benefits of visual statistics for yourself.
Angular diameter is basically the size that something appears to be, given the fact that it's a certain distance away from you. It's usually reported in units like degrees, arc minutes, or arc seconds, and you can calculate it using some very basic trigonometry. If you have 20/20 vision, whether or not you need glasses to help you get there, it means you can resolve an angular diameter as low as 1 arc minute. In other words, if you're standing 20 feet, or roughly 6 meters, away from the chart in your doctor's office, each horizontal segment in the capital E would have to be about 1.8 millimeters thick for you to tell that it's actually an E and not a smudge. And since there are 5 segments, black, white, black, white, black, the smallest E you could read with 20/20 vision from that distance is 5 times 1.8, or 9 millimeters tall. But you may have noticed the moon is not 6 meters away from you. A 9 millimeter anything on the lunar surface would be completely unreadable, even to the Hubble Space Telescope. So, how tall would a lunar E need to be to maintain 1 arc minute minimum? Here's where we have to make some assumptions and deal with some more back-of-the-envelope calculations. For one thing, we have to look through Earth's atmosphere, which can technically blur our view of the moon. We'll ignore that for the sake of our math. But since some of you out there might be burgeoning astrophotographers, if not desperate to draw visible memes on the moon, it's worth noting that scientists do have ways to report how bad this blurring effect will be on a particular day. Instead, we mostly have to deal with the fact that the moon keeps moving. It's never a constant distance away from us. So if we want to figure out how big that E needs to be visible to everyone all the time, we'd have to use the moon's maximum distance from Earth. Or if we want to charge advertisers based on distance, maybe they could just pay less if people can only read the message some of the time. So let's just go ahead and use the average distance of 384,000 kilometers. In which case, a capital E that's 5 arc minutes tall would correspond to 560 kilometers, which is a chunk longer than the Grand Canyon. And if you want an even more complex structure, say a certain company logo, it would need to be even bigger. Those UT students couldn't possibly get their job done with their proposed fleet of 2 dinky rovers with their delicate little doodling arms, but then again, that's not what their proposal was aiming for. Although in the end, they were still trying to find a way to make money off the moon that wasn't your standard mining for resources or whatever. But hey, maybe you're not as opposed to this idea as we are. And for the record, I think if an astronaut makes it all the way to the moon and wants to stick their finger in the regolith and draw a smiley face or lay down and make a dust angel, they deserve a little treat after all those years of training. As of now, this is all still one big hypothetical. So in the spirit of hypotheticals, how about we just carve this gorgeous mug up there? Even if it's not big enough for everyone to see back home.